American Idol, Glee, and the YouTube superstar, more and more aspiring singers are seeking out voice teachers at a younger and younger age. On average, students begin voice lessons at age 15, 16, but with the overwhelming number of young singing stars in the pop and opera world, the average student is getting younger and younger, even as young as 5. Child stars like Charlotte Church and Jackie Banjo have changed the classical world for both the better and the worse. These young ladies have drawn in a greater audience to the world of classical music and opera, or what's perceived as opera, but at the same time have fooled budding singers and audiences alike to think that they can be placed on a stage and stand up against seasoned opera stars like Renee Fleming, Deborah Voigt, or Gerald Finley. This is just not the case. Unlike the popera stars of today, opera singers are not mic'd. They do not have a helping hand of amplification, remix, reverb, or auto-tune, and are still expected to be heard over a 60-piece orchestra. How does this work, you might ask? Can my 16-year-old singer sing Je Veux Vivre from Who Knows Romeo and Juliet? Or should my 15-year-old son sing Nessun Dorma from Puccini's Turandot? No. Sits just below our lungs oral cavity, nasal cavity, and pharyngeal cavity to create what comes out of our mouths. The students must learn to lift the soft palate, blocking off the nasal passage, or the nasty vocal quality to their singing, as well as letting the larynx sit in a lower position to utilize the resonant space way in the back above our throat in the pharyngeal cavity. Lastly, the voice is the one instrument that has the use of language and must use several articulators: the tongue, the jaw, the teeth, and the lips. The tongue is the largest muscle in our mouth and also attaches just above the larynx and hyoid bone. If it is tight or pulled back, it can hinder movement of the larynx and block resonance space. The jaw attaches at a hinge just by our ears and moves in a swinging motion. These two articulators are most prone to tension and try to compensate where breath support is lacking. With all articulators, words are shaped, giving meaning to the music. Now, let's look at the how. How does a student develop these technical goals? In short, a student accomplishes these technical goals through a combination of vocal exercises, appropriate music, and most importantly, time. Time must be considered when any student wishes to grow as a singer because, as was said earlier, our bodies are continually developing. Depending on the student's current development, the teacher must assign repertoire that accomplishes specific technical goals. This can be related to developing breath, articulation, resonance, frame tension, or others. To choose a piece, the teacher looks at the language and articulation requirements, the tessitura, or which part of the range is being utilized most, line or agility, and breathing requirements. With a basic understanding of what must be achieved, then let's look at the repertoire for this recital. Here in this recital, I have divided the repertoire into three sets: beginner, intermediate, and advanced. Since there is no exact science to choosing a repertoire, every singer is a case-by-case basis. In this particular case, let's assume that the singer has a general knowledge of music, a decent sense of rhythm, a background in at least one language, and is a starting freshman in college. Oh, and is a soprano. The first set is repertoire chosen for the beginning singer. The first two songs are in English to help the student feel comfortable without the language challenges. Love Has Eyes is a simple rhythmic piece that moves at a moderate pace in mostly stepwise motion, introducing the singer to the upper register. I Never Saw More is similar in its simple rhythm, but unlike Love Has Eyes, moves in large leaping motion, sitting in both the primo and secondo passaggio. This piece is more difficult as the primo and secondo passaggios are areas of the voice commonly thought of as the break, where the thyroarytenoid and cricothyroid muscles are exchanging dominance. Italian songs, Caro Mio Ben and Gian Sole dal Gange, are first and foremost used to work pure open vowels. With these open vowels, a student gets to learn how to sing clear words, as well as creating a more open space inside their mouths for resonance with the lifted soft palate. Also, by the use of the roll R, the tongue begins to release and sit in a more resting position. If you take notice, the tessitura on all of these songs never sits very high for long periods of time, and they all introduce the singer to that lower part of the register. Sopranos can more easily sing high notes, however, it is important to develop the lower portion of one's register, as it strengthens the thyroarytenoid muscle and in turn helps to develop a warmer quality to the higher register. The second set is designed for the intermediate. That is, assuming that our young singer has been developing at the desired rate and they are grasping that breath equals power, the lower register is coming in and tensions are slowly being relieved. These four pieces work together to continue to strengthen and condition the vocal folds for clarity and stamina, eliminating breathiness through vocal fold approximation, where they can come together, stabilizing the larynx from jumping up and down the neck, and for resonance capabilities and tension release. The pieces Vidmun and Obor de l'eau present language and articulation development. Neither is rhythmically difficult, except for the middle section in Vidmun that requires the student to sing a twofold pattern over the piano's triplets, but requires the navigation through two consonant-oriented languages while remembering that breath is power. Arias tend to use the greatest vocal range and also require a singer to resonate through a hall of hundreds of people. Common arias given to the young sopranos are De Vieni Non Tarda or Batti Batti from Mozart's Don Giovanni, as they are written for lighter voices. Instead, I have here chosen Gretchen am Spinnrade as our introduction to an aria. Though it is an art song, the text and the music are shaped more like an aria with a higher tessitura. After working on the Mozart and developing that consistent vocal posture, Gretchen am Spinnrade is one of those pieces that can either be fantastic or derail a student. If a student begins to lose her sense of posture or supported breath, every new breath taken should be focused on realignment. The third set, comprised of two arias by Mozart and Puccini, are written for developed lyric soprano voices, and if learned too early, the habits are extremely difficult to unlearn. At this point, the student should be close to entering the professional world. Developmentally, the singer has released most of any jaw tension or tongue tension. Transitioning between the passaggios is clean and has a clearer grasp on the requirements to maintain such a voice. Now, it is all about aligning all parts of singing, letting the colors of the voice emerge and resonate fully. As was learned earlier with Ridente da Palma, Mozart's aria Mi gradi, quell'alba ingrata is absolutely a make it or break it aria. Intense concentration is given to the breath driving the sound through that tall vertical vocal posture, again, with a lower larynx and a heightened soft palate. The opening recitative allows the student ample time to gear up for the next phrase, but the aria itself is a different monster. Moving at a rapid speed through arpeggios, melismas, and a tessitura that passes through the passaggio at higher portions of the voice at all times, there is rarely more than half a measure to refocus oneself. If the singer falls out of this posture for even a second, she will have an extremely difficult time getting to the end of the piece. Duque di Gel presents similar issues of needing to remain grounded. But here, the most difficult portion is the final section. In the final passage, the vocal line walks up from the middle voice to sit between a high F and a B for the entire last page. Because this sits so high, it is very easy for a singer to take a high breath, losing that posture already achieved, which will then make that final sustained A very difficult and potentially shrill. With a tall vocal posture, not only can the singer get through the aria with clarity, but also the sound can resonate over an orchestra into a large hall. Finally, is the piece Knoxville, Summer of 1915 by Barber. This is neither an aria nor a standard art song, but as a 25-page piece at approximately 15 minutes long, stamina alone would eliminate any young singer from undertaking this beast. Along with that, the piece visits areas of dissonance and meter change from 12-8, 4-4, to 7-8, to 15-8. Just like Mi gradi and Duque di Gel, this piece presents the same technical issues on a greater scale. Broken into five segments, each has its own challenges. From the tessitura sitting in the middle voice at a slower tempo, or a high tessitura at a very rapid tempo, or requiring grand leaps within one's range. Also, like the arias, it requires constant breath support with a vertical vocal posture. The only kicker is that it's in English. As an English speaker, there are nuances and habits retained in spoken language that can easily transfer into singing, and just as easily make it difficult for the listener to understand. As the singer learned early on in Caro Mio, focusing on pure open vowels is important in maintaining that vocal posture. However, it would be very silly if I sang, "Happy birthday to you!" The singer must instead use those pure vowels, but with the natural nuances and diphthongs in the language combined with those pure vowels for their ability to carry. It is important to know that once you've learned something, it becomes muscle memory, and again, is extremely difficult to unlearn. Several of the pieces in this program I have either sung many years ago or have taught them to other students. In that time, my muscles learned to sing these songs with my young habits or bad habits I picked up by demonstrating something for a student. When I chose these songs for this program, I time trying to unlearn bad habits before I could retain good ones. With the extreme passages, high tessitura, and demanding technical requirements, these are the exact reasons why it's not good to assign inappropriate repertoire at an early age, as well as the multiple issues mentioned before. Instead, it is best for teachers to assign music that will help the student develop, but still enjoy, so that when they do reach the appropriate level, they can fully conquer these pieces and, hopefully,